ما شاء الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the merciful, all praise is due to Allah, and may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His Prophet Muhammad, his family, his companions, and his followers all until the day of resurrection. Let me welcome you all this evening to this great event, having with us, by the grace of Allah, a great personality, a very famous scholar and orator, someone that I know you have come to see, and we only kept you for all these minutes just to be more anxious. So here we are, and indeed the best thing to start with this evening is a recitation from the glorious Quran read by His Eminence Sheikh Adil ibn Salim al-Kalbani, the Imam of Jami' al-Malik Khalid, King Khalid Jami' Mosque here in Riyadh. So please, Sheikh Adil.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ولمن خاف مقام ربه جنتان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان ذواتا أفنان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان فيهما عينان تجريان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان فيهما من كل فاكهة زوجان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان متكئين على فرش بطائنها من استبرق وجنى الجنتين دان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان فيهن قاصرات الطرف لم يطمثهن إنس قبلهم ولا جان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان كأنهن الياقوت والمرجان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان ومن دونهما جنتان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان مدهامتان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان فيهما عينان نضاختان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان فيهما فاكهة ونخل ورمان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان فيهن خيرات حسان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان حور مقصورات في الخيام فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان لم يطمثهن إنس قبلهم ولا جان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان متكئين على رفرف خضر وعبقري حسان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان تبارك اسم ربك ذي الجلال والإكرام.
شكر الله لكم. Thank you so much. May Allah accept from you. And Allah says only the truth. And let me give the meaning of these beautiful verses from the chapter Ar-Rahman. In this, the meaning of which Allah says, but for such as fear the time when they will stand before the judgment seat of their Lord, there will be two gardens. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny, containing all kinds of trees and delights? Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? In them each will be two springs flowing free. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? In them will be fruits of every kind, two and two. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? They will recline on carpets whose inner linings will be of rich brocade. The fruit of the gardens will be near and easy of reach. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? And them will be maidens, chaste, restraining their glances, whom no man or jinn before them has touched. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Like unto rubies and coral, then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? And there any reward, is there any reward for good other than good? Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? And beside these two, there are two other gardens. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Dark green in color from plentiful watering. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? And them each will be two springs pouring forth water in continuous abundance. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? And them will be fruits and dates and pomegranates. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? And them will be fair companions, good, beautiful. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Companions restrained as to their glances in goodly pavilions. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Whom no man or jinn before them has touched. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Reclining on green cushions and rich carpets of beauty. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? Blessed be the name of your Lord, full of majesty, bounty, and honor. So this is the end of these beautiful verses read by Sheikh Adil Al-Kalbani. Jazahullahu khayran. May Allah reward him in abundance. Let me, after this, introduce our speaker tonight, our guest, coming from the state of India, our dear brother, Dr. Zakir Naik. And if I may just pronounce this as Zakir Naik. Now, kindly, I know that you're so eager to show respect to our guest. However, we would prefer not to have any clapping, kindly. And at the same time, no clapping of your mobiles as well. So please turn off your mobiles and kindly make dua for Dr. Zakir, as for all those who are organizing this great event this evening. And as part of Al Janadriya Festival, we are so happy and glad that, alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah, this event has come into being. Now, Dr. Zakir Naik, in brief, is a medical doctor by professional training, and he is a renowned, dynamic, international orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Naik is the president of the Islamic Research Foundation in Mumbai, India. Dr. Zakir clarifies Islamic viewpoints and clear misconceptions about Islam by the grace of Allah, using the glorious Quran, the authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, and other religious scriptures as a basis, in conjunction with reason, logic, and scientific facts. He's 42 years old before discount. He's also popular for critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audience after his public talks. And this is, alhamdulillah, very known to those who know him very well. And in the last 10 years, Dr. Zakir Naik has delivered more than 1,000 public talks in this country, Saudi Arabia, in the USA, Canada, the UK, United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, Qatar, Bahrain, Oman, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Botswana, Malaysia, Singapore, you name it. There are so many countries, and of course, along that, India. We cannot ignore the very homeland of Dr. Zakir, India, along with Hong Kong, Thailand, Guyana, another beautiful country in South America, and many, many other countries. He's successfully participated in several symposia and dialogues with prominent personalities of other faiths. His public dialogue with Dr. William Campbell of the USA on the topic Quran and the Bible in the light of science, held in Chicago in the USA in April of the year 2000, was a resounding success. So let me tell you this about Sheikh Ahmed Didat, and you know Sheikh Ahmed Didat, may Allah have mercy on his soul, who is a very famous orator on Islam and comparative religion. He had called Dr. Zakir Naik his Didat Plus, and this was in 1994, where he presented a plaque in May of 2000 with the engraving with these following words: awarded to Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik for his achievements in the field of da'wah and the study of comparative religion. Son, what you have done in 4 years had taken me 40 years to accomplish, alhamdulillah. And now let's multiply these 4 years into another 40, inshallah, and more, so we can achieve more from Dr. Naik. May Allah give him long life in the service of his deen. Now, Dr. Zakir Naik appears regularly on many international TV channels in more than 150 countries in the world. He's also in care of Peace Television, and I'm so glad that Peace Television has come into being because I had the honor to be a guest again with so many other brothers and sisters who came to India in Mumbai in last November. We were glad that we did and made that trip and saw the great work of all the dedicated people of Peace TV and IRF, or the Islamic Research Foundation, and the great success of having so many people coming to events held by Peace TV and the IRF. Now, without further delay, I'd like to invite my dear, respected brother, Dr. Dhakir Naik, for a very interesting title. Now, I'd be wondering, like you, what is the meaning of this particular title? He will disclose this for us tonight, the Kingdom of Peace. So please welcome with me Dr. Dhakir Naik. Without clapping, please.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Inna ad-dina indallahi al-islam. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa ahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. The honorable guest of honors, my respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. I respect the lights to be on yet. The person controlling the lights, please make the lights completely bright. Jazakallah shukran. It's a pleasure and honor for me to be invited for the second time for the Janazira festival, which is organized by the National Guards under the patronage of King Abdullah. And again, I'm giving a second talk for the festival in the same auditorium, where I've come here before many times, in this King Fahd Cultural Center. The topic of this evening's talk of mine is the Kingdom of Peace. And everyone wants to know, what is this Kingdom of Peace? And this, as far as this Kingdom of Peace, it's mentioned in all the scriptures of the world, including the glorious Quran, which was the last and final revelation of Almighty God, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse 96, it says that the first house appointed for the worship is Bakka. Bakka is another name for Mecca, in which there is blessings and guidance for all the worlds, for the whole of humankind. So Bakka, that is Makkah, is the first house appointed for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, in which there is blessing and guidance for the whole of humankind. And this Makkah is mentioned in all the scripture of the world, in all the major scripture of the major world religions. It's also mentioned in the Bible, in the book of Psalms, chapter number 84, verse number 5 and 6, which says that blessed are those people who visit the valley of Bakka, those who visit the valley of Makkah. It's also mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. It's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 3, chapter number 29, verse number 4. It speaks about Ilaispad. Ila means God, and Spad means a place. It's place of God, a place of worship. And this refers to Makkah, because further if you read in context in Rig Veda, book number 3, chapter number 29, verse number 11, it speaks about Narashansa, referring to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So this place of peace where Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam born is referring to Makkah. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him, he made a dua, which is mentioned in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 126. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, O my Lord, make this city a city of peace, and in it feed its people with fruits, those who believe in Allah and those who believe in the hereafter. So Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam made a dua that make this city of Makkah the place of peace, and feed its people with fruits, those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those who believe in the hereafter. He made another dua, which is mentioned in Surah Ibrahim, chapter number 14, verse number 35, where he prays, Ibrahim alayhi salam prays, that, O my Lord, make this a city of peace and security. Make Makkah a place of peace and security. And preserve me and my sons from worshipping the idols. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he preserve himself and his sons from worshipping the idols. And the greetings of this religion, if we analyze and compare with how people greet each other today, the most common greeting that we have today in the world, especially in the Western world, it is good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening. Even if it's raining cats and dogs, the person wishes good morning. What's good in the morning when it's raining cats and dogs? And if in a school, if a teacher enters the class, all the students wish, good morning, sir. Maybe the sir had a fight with his wife. He may never want the morning to come again, but yet he has to wish back, good morning to you too. We have various other greetings like hello, informal way of greeting, hi. But the best and the universal greeting is the greeting of peace. Assalamu alaikum. May peace be on you. And this was a greeting even used by Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 24, verse number 36, where he goes in the upper room, and when he comes to the apostles, he says, Shalom alaikum in Hebrew, which means Assalamu alaikum in Arabic. In English, it means peace be on you. And it's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Anam, chapter number 6, verse number 54. وَإِذَا جَاءَكَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِآيَاتِنَا فَقُلْ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Whenever you meet those who believe in our signs, say, peace be on you. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 86, that whenever a courteous greeting is given to you, meet it with a greeting still more courteous, or at least of equal courtesy. For Allah is careful in keeping of accounts. That means if someone wishes you assalamu alaikum, you have to wish back walaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. If someone wishes you assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you have to wish back walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You have to wish back more courteously. If someone says assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, if you cannot better, at least say the same walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If someone says assalamu alaikum, and if you say walaikum assalam, that is coming from the depths of the heart. The word may be same, but the greeting is more courteous. So the universal greeting of Islam and other religion, it is peace, the greeting of peace. Not only does the Quran prescribe that when you meet each other, you have to greet peacefully, but even in times of problems, for example, the Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 63, that when those people are the followers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who walk on this earth with humility, and when the ignorant approach them, they say peace, they say qalu salama. That means when the ignorant also approach them, they say qalu salama, they say peace. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Qasas, chapter number 28, verse number 55, that they are the people when there is vain talks, they walk therefrom, and they say, may peace be on you, assalamu alaikum, we seek not the ignorant. Even at times of war, the Quran prescribes peace. The verse which is very often quoted to malign Islam, that Islam is the religion which says that to kill the kafir, Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verse number 5, where I've always quoted in my talk very often about the context, that wherever you find the kafir, you have to kill them. It's out of context, it's talking about the battlefield. That in the battlefield, Allah says to the Muslims that if the enemies come, don't get scared, kill them. But the next verse says, people normally jump to verse number 7 because verse number 6 has the answer. Verse number 6 of Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9 says that if the enemies want peace, if they seek asylum, don't just give it to them, escort them to a place of security so that they may hear the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even at times of war, when enemies seek peace, the Quran says, don't just give it to them, escort them to a place of security so that they may hear the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verse of Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 60, which says that prepare your steeds of war against the enemies and cause terror in the hearts of the enemies. But immediately the next verse says, Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse 61, but if the enemies want peace, you too take peace, you too give them peace. So peace is a form of greeting in times of trouble. Even at times of war, the best prescribed solution is peace. And further, if you analyze, it's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Fatiha, chapter number 1, verse number 3, Malik Yawm al-Din, the master of the day of judgment, or the king of the day of judgment, Malik Yawm al-Din. It's further mentioned in Surah Al-Hashr, chapter 59, verse number 23. It says, Malikul Quddus was Salam, the king, the sovereign. It says, the source of peace, As-Salam. It's referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, that He is the king, He is the master, He is the sovereign. He is the source of peace. As-salam. And the Quran mentions in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse 187. It says that for them is the home of peace in the presence of thy Lord. For thy Lord is their friend. And because they are righteous. So it's talking about the home of peace. The kingdom of peace is in the presence of thy Lord. For your Lord is your friend. And he loves you because you are righteous. It's mentioned in Surah Ma'arij, chapter number 70, verse number 27 and 28. That they fear the displeasure of thy Lord. For displeasure of the Lord is opposite of peace and tranquility. They fear to displease the Lord, talking about the believers. Because if you displease God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the opposite of peace and tranquility. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 58. The salam, peace, it is the word from the Lord who is most merciful. It's mentioned in Surah Ibrahim, chapter 14, verse number 23. It says that those people who believe, those who have faith and do righteous work, these are the people that shall enter paradise, under which, beneath which are rivers flowing, and the greetings in this paradise is peace. Here it's talking about the criteria that if you believe, if you have faith and you do righteous work, then you shall enter Jannah, beneath which rivers will flow. It's mentioned in Surah Hijr, chapter 15, verse number 46, that the greetings is enter with peace and security. It's mentioned in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 75, that the highest reward in Jannah and Paradise is those who are patient constants. Those who strive for patience and constancy. It's mentioned in Surah Maryam, chapter 19, verse number 62, that in paradise there is no vain talk. There is no idle talk. There is only salutations of peace. And this kingdom of peace, the ultimate kingdom of peace, is Jannah. It is heaven. It's paradise. And the description of this kingdom of peace is mentioned in the scriptures of the major world religions. And if you read the Quran, it speaks about the kingdom of peace. One of its name is Jannah. That is paradise. The meaning of Jannah in Arabic is garden. A description is given as garden beneath which rivers flow. Rivers of milk with unchanging flavor. Rivers of pure honey in which there is every kind of fruit. And the fruits are described as pomegranates, dates, grapes, etc. And in it you will find that there is no idle talk. There is no vain talk. There is no cause of sin or no cause of distress or anxiety. It is a total place. It's a place of total peace and bliss. And Jannah is described in several verses of the Quran. Several times in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, Surah Nisa, chapter 4, Surah Maidah, chapter 5, Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, Surah Hijr, chapter 15, Surah Qahf, chapter 18, Surah Hajj, chapter 22, Surah Fatir, chapter 35, Surah Yasin, chapter 36, several places the Quran speaks about this Jannah, about the kingdom of peace. And the same description of the kingdom of peace is given even in the Hindu scriptures. In several places, time will not permit to describe all, but it's mentioned in Atharvaveda, book number 4, chapter number 36, verse number 6. Atharvaveda, book number 4, chapter 34, verse number 6. It says that this heaven, it's talking about, it has got rivers flowing beneath, streams of butter with banks of pure honey, rivers of distilled water and curd, and rivers of milk. In several places it speaks about fruits. It's mentioned in Atharvaveda, book number 4, chapter number 36, verse number 2, that it is a place of happiness where you will find pure women. The same description of kingdom of peace is also given in the Bible. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 22, verse number 30, that when a person is resurrected, that person does not marry and cannot be married because they become angels of God. It's mentioned in the book of Romans, chapter number 21, verse number 4, that this is a place where there will be no sorrow. All your tears will be wiped out by Almighty God. There will not be death. There will not be pain. There will not be grief. It's mentioned in the Song of Solomon, chapter number 4, verse number 13, that in it are gardens and fruits, including pomegranates, etc. So the description of Jannah, the kingdom of peace, is given in the major, the scriptures of the major world religions. And the criteria to go to Jannah, it is the same. It's mentioned in Surah Al-Asr, chapter 3, verse number 103. Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 3, which says, "Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa allazina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr." That by the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deed, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. There are basically two criteria required for Jannah, to go to Jannah, to go to kingdom of peace. It is Iman and righteous deed. In this Surah Al-Asr, more details are given of the second criteria, therefore it becomes four. One is Iman, righteous deed, exhorting people to truth, and exhorting people to patience and perseverance. And the key to go to Jannah is the first pillar of Islam, mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, hadith number 8, which is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, that there is no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. The key to Jannah, in the scriptures of the major world religion, it is the same. That is, believing in no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. And this talk major deals with the key to the kingdom of peace, the key to Jannah. First, we'll discuss the first criteria, the concept of God in the major world religions. First, we'll discuss the key to the concept of God in Hinduism. If you ask a common Hindu that how many gods does he believe in, some will say 3, some will say 100, some will say thousands, while others will say 33 crores, 330 million. But if you ask a learned Hindu, he will tell you that the Hindus should believe and worship only one God. But the common Hindu, he believes in a philosophy known as pantheism. He believes that everything is God. The common Hindu believes that the tree is God, the sun is God, the moon is God, the human being is God, the snake is God. What we Muslims believe is everything is God's, G-O-D with an apostrophe S. Everything belongs to God. The tree belongs to God, the sun belongs to God, the moon belongs to God, the human being belongs to God, the sun belongs to God. So the major difference between the Hindus and the Muslims is, the common Hindu says that everything is God. We Muslims, they say everything is God's, G-O-D with an apostrophe S. The major difference is the apostrophe S. If we can solve this difference of apostrophe S, the Hindus and the Muslims will be united. How do you do it? The Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, Talaw ila kalmitin sawa'im bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'buda illallah. That we worship none but Allah. And to understand the concept of God in a religion, it is not appropriate to observe what the followers of that religion are doing. The best and the most authentic way to understand the concept of God in a religion is to try and understand what the scripture of that religion has to speak about Almighty God. So let's try and understand the concept of God in Hinduism based on the scriptures of Hinduism. It's mentioned in the Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1. Ekam evidityam. God is only one without a second. It's mentioned in the Shweta Sitara Upanishad, chapter number 6, verse number 9. Nachasya kasij janita na chadipa. It's a Sanskrit quotation which means, of that God, there are no parents. He has got no lords. Almighty God has got no father. He has got no mother. He has got no superior. It's mentioned in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. The meaning of pratima in Sanskrit means images, photographs, pictures, sculptures, statues, idols. Of that God, there is no pratima. Of that God, there are no images. There are no pictures. There are no portraits. There are no paintings. There are no statues. There are no idols. There are no sculptures. And the most sacred scripture, which is most widely read, it is the Bhagavad Gita. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 7, verse number 20. All those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods. Means that the materialistic people, they do idol worship. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 10, verse number 3. They know me as the unborn, the supreme, the Lord of all the worlds. And amongst the Hindu scriptures, the most sacred are the Vedas. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. As I mentioned earlier, pratima means images, photographs, paintings, pictures, idols, sculptures, statues. Of that God, there is no pratima. Of that God, there are no images. There are no pictures. There are no paintings. There are no portraits. There are no sculptures. There are no statues. There are no idols. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter number 40, verse number 8. Almighty God is pure and imageless. It's mentioned in Yajurved, chapter number 40, verse number 9. Andhatma pavishanti ya asamuti mupaste. They are entering darkness, those who worship the Asambhuti. Asambhuti are the natural things like fire, water, air, etc. And the verse continues, they are entering more in darkness, those who worship the Sambhuti. Sambhuti are the created things like table, chair, idols, etc. Who says that? Yajurved, chapter 40, verse number 9. It's mentioned in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 58, verse number 3. Dev Maha Asi. Great is Almighty God. And the most sacred amongst all the Vedas is the Rig Veda. It's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 1, hymn number 164, verse 46. Ekam Sat Vipra Bahuda Vadante. Truth is one, God is one. Sages, saintly people call him by a variety of names. And there are no less than 33 different attributes given to Almighty God in Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1 alone. One amongst the attribute in Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, is Brahma. Brahma is called as the creator. If you translate into Arabic, it means Khalik. If you translate into English, it means creator. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Khalik or creator. But if someone says Almighty God is Brahma, who has got four heads and on each head is a crown, we Muslims take strong objection to it. Moreover, you are giving an image to Almighty God and going against Sweta Sitar Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, which says, Na tasipatima asti, of that God, there are no images. The other attribute given in Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, is Vishnu. If you translate Vishnu, Vishnu is called as the sustainer. If you translate sustainer into Arabic, it means Rabb. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Rabb or sustainer. But if someone says Almighty God is Vishnu, who has got four hands, one of its hands is the discus, the chakra, and the other hand he has the conch, he is traveling on the sea, on the bed of snakes, or in the air, traveling on the bird by the name of Garuda, we Muslims take strong objection to it. Moreover, you are giving an image to Almighty God and going against Yajurved, chapter number 32, verse number 3, which says, Na tasipatim asti, of that God, there are no images. It's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 8, hymn number 1, verse number 1. Ma chidanidhi sansad, worship him alone. It's mentioned in Rig Veda, book number 6, hymn number 45, verse number 16. Ya ik it mushtihi, praise him alone. Praise Almighty God alone. And the Brahma Sutra of Hinduism is, Ikkam Braham Devta Naste, Nena Naste Kinchan. Bhagwan Eki hai, Dusra Nahi hai, Nahi hai, Nahi hai, Zara bhi Nahi hai. There is only one God. Not at all, there is only one God, not a second, not at all, not at all, not in the least bit. So if you read the Hindu scriptures, you shall understand the concept of God in Hinduism, and you'll understand the key to the kingdom of heaven, to the kingdom of peace. Let's discuss the concept of God in Judaism. It's mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 6, verse number 4. Moses, peace be upon him, says, Shema Israelo Adnahinu Adnaychad, Yoro Israel, the Lord, our God, is one Lord. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 43, verse number 11. I, even I am Lord, and besides me, there is no other Savior. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 45, verse number 5. I am God, and there's none else. There is no God besides me. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 46, verse number 9. I am God and there's none else. I am God and there's none like me. It's further mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 5, verse number 7 and 8. Thou shalt have none other God besides me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image of anything, of any likeness in the heaven above, in the earth beneath, and the water beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor serve them, for I, thy God, thy Lord, is a jealous God. A similar message repeated in the book of Exodus, chapter number 20, verse number 3 to 5, which says, Thou shalt have no other God besides me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image of anything, of any likeness, in the heaven above, in the earth beneath, and the water beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor serve them, for I, thy God, thy Lord, is a jealous God. If you read the Old Testament, and if you read the Torah, you shall understand the concept of God in Judaism, and understand the key to the kingdom of peace. Let's discuss the concept of God in Christianity. Before we do that, I'd like to make a few points clear. That Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes an article of faith to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of Almighty God. We believe that he was the Messiah, translated Christ. We believe that he healed those born blind and lepers with God's permission. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern day Christians today do not believe. The Muslims and the Christians, we are going together. But one may ask, then where is the parting of ways? The parting of ways is that most of the Christians, they believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he claimed divinity. They believe that he was Almighty God. In fact, if you read the Bible, there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. I would like to repeat that. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible, not a single unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, or where he says worship me. In fact, if you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29, my Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28, I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20, I with the finger of God cast out devil. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says, I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God, he is a Muslim. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was a Muslim. He clearly mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 17 to 20, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, think not that I have come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have come not to destroy, but to fulfill. And until the heavens and the earth pass away, not one jot or tittle shall pass away from the law until all be fulfilled. And whosoever shall break one of the least commandments and teach men to do so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. And whosoever shall keep the commandments and teach the same will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Unless your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, in no way shall you enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, if you want to enter the kingdom of peace, you have to follow all the laws and commandments which were mentioned by Moses, peace be upon him, that Almighty God is one. He has got no images. You cannot make images of Almighty God. And further, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 24, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that the words that you hear are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 3. This is life eternal, so that you may know the one true God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 19, verse number 16 to 17. A person comes to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and says that, good master, what good things should I do so that I shall enter the kingdom of heaven, so that I may achieve eternal life? So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, replies that, why thou callest me good? There is only one good, that is Almighty God. And if thou want to enter eternal life, if you want to go to the kingdom of peace, you should keep the commandments. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did not say that if you want to enter heaven, you believe that I died for your sins, that you believe that I am Almighty God. He said that if you want to enter the kingdom of peace, if you want to enter heaven, if you want to enter Jannah, you have to keep the commandments. And it's clearly mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. Ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you, by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. A man approved of God amongst you, by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. And when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was asked that which is the first of the commandment, he repeated verbatim what was said by Moses, peace be upon him, earlier. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 12, verse number 29. He said, Shema Israelo Adnahinu Adnechad, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. So if you read the Bible, you shall understand the concept of God in Christianity and understand the key to the kingdom of heaven, to the kingdom of peace. Let's discuss the concept of God in Islam. The best reply that any Muslim can give you regarding the concept of God in Islam is quote to you Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, Kul huwa Allahu ahd. Say He is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute and eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahd. There is nothing like Him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, given in the glorious Quran in Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4. Any person says that so and so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. The first is, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say He is Allah one and only. The second is, Allahu samad. Allah, the absolute and eternal. The third is, Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is He begotten. And the fourth is, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدْ. There's nothing like Him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, given in the glorious Quran, which is the touchstone of theology. Theo means God, logy means study, theology is the study of God. Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology, the touchstone of the study of God. Any candidate, any human being is worshipping as God, put him to the test of Surah Ikhlas and you'll come to know whether the God you are worshipping is true or not. For example, there are some human beings who believe that Bhagwan Rajneesh is God. Let's put Bhagwan Rajneesh to test. The first test is Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say is Allah one and only. Was Bhagwan Rajneesh the only man who claimed divinity? There are hundreds men who have claimed divinity, and especially for my country, there are more than 1,000 who have claimed divinity. Is he the only one? But Rajneesh Bhakti will say, no, he is unique. Okay, let's go to the next test. Allahu Samad, Allah, the absolute and eternal. When we read the autobiography of Bhagwan Rajneesh, we come to know that he was suffering from asthma, from diabetes mellitus, from chronic backache. Imagine Almighty God suffering from asthma, diabetes mellitus, chronic backache. Third test, Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is begotten. We know Bhagwan Rajneesh, he was born in Madhya Pradesh. He had a mother and father. In 1981, he goes to America and he takes thousands of Americans for a ride. He goes to the state of Oregon and starts his own village called as Rajneeshpuram. Later on, the American government, they arrest him and they put him behind bars. And Rajneesh, he alleges that the American government, they gave me slow poisoning. Imagine Almighty God being slow poisoned. And the last test, and later on, in 1985, the American government, they kick him out of the country and he comes back to Pune, where he had a center, and he renames it as Osho Commune. And if you go to Pune to his center, Osho Commune, and when you go to, you find on the stone on his samadhi, it's mentioned there that Bhagwan Rajneesh, Osho, never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. Never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. They forgot to mention in his samadhi that he was not given visas to 21 different countries of the world. Imagine Almighty God, He is coming down to visit the world and requires visas to go to different countries. And the Archbishop of Greece said, if you don't remove Rajneesh out of this country, we'll burn his house and the house of his disciple. And the last test, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَوْ كُفْوًا أَحَدْ. There's nothing like him, is so stringent that no one besides the true Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can pass. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, He is not God. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَوْ كُفْوًا أَحَدْ. And we know Bhagwan Rajneesh, he wore a white robe, like the human beings, he had one nose, two eyes, two ears, two hands. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, He is not God. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدْ. For example, if someone says that Almighty God is 1,000 times stronger than Arnold Schwarzenegger. You know Arnold Schwarzenegger, the person who got the title Mr. World, the strongest man in the world, Mr. Universe, the strongest man in the universe. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, whether it be 1,000 times or whether it be 1,000,000 times, whether it be Arnold Schwarzenegger or whether it be Dara Singh or whether it be King Kong, the moment you can compare God to anything in this world, He is not God. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like Him. So this is a 4-line definition of Almighty God given in Surah Ikhlas. This is the touchstone for theology. Any God that you are worshipping, put him to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If he passes, he is the true God and he is the true key for your kingdom of peace. So if you understand the concept of God according to Surah Al-Ikhlas, you will have the correct key for the kingdom of peace. Without this key for the kingdom of peace, you cannot enter the kingdom of peace. That is the ultimate kingdom of peace. Let's go to the second criteria for the kingdom of peace. The first we completed, La ilaha illallah. The second is Muhammad Rasulullah. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Almighty God. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the last and final messenger of Almighty God, is mentioned in the scriptures of all the major world religions. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse number 24, وَأُمْ مِنْ إِمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَافِيَا نَزِيرٍ وَأُمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَافِيَا نَزِيرٍ. There is not a nation or a tribe whom we have not sent a warner or a guide. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Ra, chapter number 13, verse number 7, وَلِكُلِّكُمْ مِنْ هَادٍ. And to every people have He sent a warner. By name, 25 are mentioned in the glorious Quran, but our beloved Prophet Muhammad said there were 124,000 messengers sent on the face of the earth. By name, only 25 are mentioned in the Quran. But all the messengers that came before the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only meant for a particular group of people, and the message which they got was supposed to be followed till a particular time period. Because Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger, he was not sent only for the Muslims or the Arabs. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. That we have sent thee not but as a mercy to all the worlds, as a mercy to all the creatures, as a mercy to the whole of humanity. It's mentioned in Surah Sabah, chapter 34, verse 28. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَزِيرًا. That we have sent thee not but as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings and warning them against sin. But most of the human beings yet do not know. And this messenger, the last and final messenger of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is mentioned in the scriptures of all the major world religions. First we'll discuss Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in Jewish scriptures. Time will not permit us to discuss in detail about the Prophet Muhammad. If you refer to my video, I said Muhammad in the world religious scriptures, it is a talk of more than 1.5 hours, which I don't intend giving here. I'll just give the references. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is prophesied in the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 19, in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12, including the Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse number 16, he is mentioned by name. There are several references I can quote only of the Old Testament. I'll just mention the Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse number 16, which says, Hikkum amitakim vikulli muhammadin zaydudi zairayo baina Jerusalem, which means, He is most sweet. He is altogether lovely. He is my beloved, O daughters of Jerusalem. Now here, the word used is Muhammadim. In the Semitic languages, Im is added as a plural of respect. For Allah, for Allah, for God, they add Im, Elohim. Means, it's a plural of respect. Similarly to the word Muhammad, they have added in, therefore it will be Muhammadin. But in the Bible they have translated as altogether lovely. but the name of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is there in the original manuscripts of the Bible. I'll just give you the references of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the New Testament. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is prophesied in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 16, in the Gospel of John, chapter number 15, verse number 26, in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7, as well as Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11 to 14, where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he heareth shall he speak. He shall glorify me. This prophecy in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11 to 14, speaks about none but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It says that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hear shall he speak. He shall glorify me. And you know, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam got a wahi. The Quran was a wahi, a revelation from Almighty God. Whatever he heard, whatever he received as a wahi, as a revelation, he repeated verbatim. And he is the only messenger of Almighty God after Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, who has glorified him, who has glorified Jesus, peace be upon him, and that is mentioned in the Quran. We'll discuss the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon Hindu scripture. Again, time will not permit me to go through all the prophecies. I'll just give some of the references. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is prophesied in Hindu scriptures in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyaya 3, Shlokas 5 to 8. He's also prophesied in Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyaya 3, Shlokas 10 to 27. He's prophesied in the Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, verse number 1 to 14, which is called as Kuntap Suktas. He's prophesied in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 6. He's prophesied in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 7. He's also prophesied in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 53, verse number 9. He is called as Ahmad in Sam Ved, Uttarchik, verse number 1500. He is also mentioned in Sam Ved, Indra, chapter number 2, verse 52. He's called as Ahmad in Yajur Ved, chapter 31, verse number 18. In Rig Ved, book number 8, chapter number 6, verse number 10. In Atharva Ved, book number 8, hymn number 5, verse number 16. In Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 14. He is called as Narashansa in the Hindu scriptures. Nar means a man. Shansa means one who is praiseworthy. A man who is praiseworthy. This is exactly the translation of the Arabic word Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which means praiseworthy. So he is mentioned as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Narashansa, in several places in the Hindu scriptures. In Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 13, verse number 3. In Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 8, verse number 19. He is mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 106, verse number 4. In Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 142, verse number 3. In Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 3, verse number 2. In Rig Ved, book number 5, hymn number 5, verse number 2. In Rig Ved, book number 7, hymn number 2, verse number 2. In Rig Ved, book number 10. In Rig Ved, book number 10, hymn number 64, verse number 3. In Rig Ved, book number 10, hymn number 182, verse number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse 37. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse 57. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 31. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 55. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 19. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 42. I can go on quoting only the references where Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is mentioned as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Hindu scriptures. If we have to talk and discuss Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam only in Hindu scripture, even one day will not be sufficient. I will just mention in brief about one prophecy, as I did for every scripture, about the Kalki avatar. It's mentioned in the Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 4, 5, 7, 9, 11 and 15. It gives the description of the last and final messenger to come, known as Kalki Avatar. And it says that his father's name will be Vishnu Yash. Translated means the servant of God, In Arabic, it means Abdullah, which is the name of the father of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It says his mother's name will be Sumati. Translated into English means peace and serenity. Into Arabic, it means Amina, which was the name of the mother of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It says that he will be born in the city of Sambhal, in the city of peace, which, you know, the city of peace is Makkah. It says that he will be born in the house of the chief of the city of peace. And we know Prophet Muhammad was born in the house of Quraysh. It says that he will be born on the 12th month of Madhav. We know Prophet Muhammad was born on 12th Rabbi Awal. It says that this messenger will be the Antim Rishi, will be the last and final messenger. And we know Prophet Muhammad was the last and final messenger mentioned in Surah Azab chapter 33 verse 40. It says that he will get the first revelation in a mountain. You know Muhammad got the first revelation in Jabal Nur, in Gar-e Hira. It says that this messenger will go northwards and then come back. You know Prophet Muhammad migrated from Makkah to Medina northwards and came back. It says that this final messenger will fight against the devil with the help of four companions. And you know the four companions referring to is the four Khulafa Rashidin. That is Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Umar, Hazrat Usman, Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with them all. And it says that he will be helped by the angels in the battlefield. And we know Prophet Muhammad was helped by the angels in the battlefield, which mentioned the Quran in several places, including Surah Al-Imran as well as Surah Anfal, chapter number 3 and chapter number 8. So if you read the Hindu scriptures, you shall understand that the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who is the second part of the key for a person to go to the kingdom of peace. So if anyone wants to go to the kingdom of peace, he first has to try and understand and realize and worship only the one true God and believe in the teachings of the last and final messenger of this God, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Only if you understand and follow and worship this one true God and his last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then only can you enter this kingdom of heaven. I would like to end my talk by quoting the verse of the Quran we started my talk with, from Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 19, which says, "Inna deena indallahi al-Islam," the only way of life, the only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah is submitting your will to Almighty God. The only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah is the religion of Islam, the religion of peace. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallahu khairan. Thank you so much, Dr. Dhakir. You inspired all of us, as you always do. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Now we'll give you some rest while we are ready to take questions, and we have 5 mics around the halls here and also in the women's section for our brothers and gentlemen. We have 1 and 2, and every mic, by the way, is numbered, so there's a number. And also we have for ladies number 3, and there's 3 and 4, but 4 has to go to 3, and they will be directed to that which is number 3. And also we have also 5 and 6 on the second floor for our gentlemen. So we do have a total of 5 mics, and we will be starting with mic number 1 here in this hall. And I hope that the mic is ready and the questioners are ready. Are they lining up? And of course we have priority for our guests, non-Muslims. They do have priority over others, and if you would kindly give them that precedence. One question at a time, and make it so brief and concise, and please provide your name and your profession, please. Go ahead.
Please go there. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Farooq Sharif Abdullah. Some banks are offering commissions on the terms of what is in Saudi Arabia. Is it acceptable?
Excuse me, brother. As the chairperson said, that would request that if there are any non-Muslim friends of ours, non-Muslim brothers of ours, I request them that they should be given the first chance. If they are non-Muslim, they are most welcome to come on the microphone. Believe me, you can ask any questions, even if it is out of the topic. For the non-Muslim, it's allowed. Any question on Islam and compared to religion, the non-Muslims are most free, they are most welcome to come and ask the questions. Please feel free to ask any questions on Islam and compared to religion. You have been in this country for many years, many of you. Any question on Islam and compared to religion, please feel free to ask. We'll first give opportunity to our non-Muslim brothers and sisters, and after they have exhausted, then we'll give a chance to the Muslim. If they're non-Muslim, they're most welcome to come on the microphone and ask the question. Any question on Islam and compared to religion, any question you have regarding the Quran, even if it's a negative, even if it is a criticism, I can take it, I'm young. Any non-Muslims who like to ask a question, they're most welcome. And always there has been a situation that whenever I come, when I travel, including Saudi Arabia, including Riyadh, always the non-Muslims are taking the precedence. Any non-Muslim? Where? Okay, most welcome, brother.
Please. You are a Muslim? Non-Muslim.
Now, thank you so much for this cooperation on the part of the Muslims to give our guests and friends and brothers and sisters from the non-Muslim community to give them first chance, please. So, do we have first questioner, please? Go ahead.
Yes.
Could you please open? Go ahead.
You are mentioned in Rijved and
name and profession, please,
Mohan.
If possible, if you'd like to.
Mohan, I am working in an advertising company as a salesman. You are mentioned in Rijved, Ajurved, and so many Hindu script. There are mentioned Muhammad, main Rasul. Okay, why can't you follow by that scripture? Why are you going to follow that Quran?
Brother, ask a very good question. And ask a very good question. I appreciate the question. He said that in Rig Ved, Yajur Ved, Sam Ved, where Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, mentioned, why don't you follow the scripture? Why don't you follow Ved? Why are you following the Quran? Brother, I am following the Ved. Your Veda says follow the Quran. Your Veda says that an Antim Rishi will come. The last and final messenger will come, whose father's name will be Abdullah, mother's name will be Amina, will be born in Makkah. So I am following your scripture. Your scripture says follow the last and final Rishi.
Please.
I am asking you, brother, why aren't you following your Veda? Why don't you follow the Quran and why don't you follow the last and final messenger? My question to you, brother.
It is mentioned in all Hindu scripture, no?
Then sorry?
You follow it.
What are you saying?
It is mentioned in Hindu scripture. Which is comes first? Hindu scripture or Quran?
No, that's a very good question. That which has come first? Hindu scripture or the Quran? So why don't you follow what has come first? Whether always what comes first is not correct. If you go and buy a Mercedes, the old model Mercedes, 1960, and the latest model 2008, which would you prefer? The new model or the old model?
Please.
Always the old model is not no, always yeah. good, or the new model is always, it's not the new is always good or the old is good. What is haq is the best. Islam doesn't believe in old or new. Many a time old is good, but it's not always true. Fine. What you have to realize, to find out which is the truth. Whatever is old is not always good, and whatever is new is also not always good. For example, if you have water kept outside for a long period, maybe for 6 months, and now you have fresh water come from aqua guard, from a filter, which is good, old or the new? Yeah, the new is good. The old is not good. Old for 6 months it has been out in the open. There is stagnation. Germs may have got in. On the other hand, if you have new water which is not distilled, and old water and distilled water for 6 months kept airtight, then the old is good. So it does not work where old is good or new is good. What is haq is correct. What is the truth is correct. Ekam sat. Rig Veda, book number 1, hymn number 164, verse 46. Ekam sat viprabhante. Ekam sat viprabhante. Truth is one. God is one. Sages call him by different names. What we have to realize, if you follow the scripture, whether the Vedas, whether the Ramayana, whether Mahabharat, whether Bible, all of them culminate to the last and final revelation, the glorious Quran. All of the scriptures say, follow the last and final messenger to come. So if you follow the Bible, the Old Testament or the New Testament, if you follow the Vedas, if you follow the Upanishads, you have to follow the when the last and final is out, that is the ultimate. Then the old need not be followed. Once you get the new version, then the old need not be followed. Till the new version has come, the old carries weight. Now when the new version has come, when the ultimate Rishi has come, you don't have to follow the awwal Rishi, the first Rishi. You have to follow the last and final Rishi, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the last and final message, the glorious Quran.
It hope that answers the question. It is also mentioned in Hindu scripture, no?
Sorry?
Narashamsa. You told me that Muhammad Rasul will come last Antim Rishi. It is mentioned in Hindu scripture.
Yes.
Why can't you follow it?
Sorry?
In Hindu scripture, it is mentioned Antim Rishi.
Yes.
Then why can't you follow it?
Follow the Antim Rishi?
Yeah.
That's what I'm doing. I'm following the Antim Rishi.
But you are translated it into Quran.
Brother, when it says Antim Rishi is going to come, and it's clearly mentioned the name of the Antim Rishi.
Yeah.
Father's name is Vishnu Yash Abdullah. Mother's name is Sumati Amina. Born in city of peace, Makkah. Do you know any other person who fits this criteria? No. Do you know anyone else?
I don't know.
Do you know anyone else? There's no one else who fits all these criteria. And if you hear my lecture, there are 1,000 criteria I've given. Here I just mentioned a few. Time is limited. Because the talk is not Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Hindu scripture. So if you see, if you have to follow this scripture says the Antim Rishi is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Same with the Bible. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11, I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. Jesus Christ is saying that you cannot bear them now. Means at that time, at that time when the Injil was revealed, that time people could not absorb. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, will come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself, all that he shall speak. So here Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is prophesizing that a final messenger will come. Because you cannot absorb, the human being at that time could not absorb the Quran, could not absorb the truth, the ultimate truth. What could be digested? For example, if my son wants to become a doctor, I will not tell him, okay, go to a medical college directly. First, I say, go to standard 1, standard 2, standard 3, pass 10 standard, then go to medical college, correct? So at that time, I can't tell my son, okay, you want to become a doctor, go to medical college directly. He has to go to the schooling. So Almighty God knows when is the best time a person can absorb. Now once you have reached that level, then you did not go to standard 1. Once you have passed standard 10, have become a graduate, then when you go to a medical college and become a doctor, then you have to follow the medical books. You don't have to follow standard 1, standard 2. Fine? You have to follow what is the last. So similarly, all the scriptures point out to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So hopefully, I'm ready for you to accept the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, and the true Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Then one more question, please.
Thank you.
One more question, please. You said Brahma
have... Excuse me, brother. We have some others. We need to give them the chance as well. I think what you have asked probably is enough. Maybe after the session, if you'd like to meet Dr. Thacker, he's willing to see you. Go behind, inshallah. And we will get you, inshallah. Go ahead, brother. Here.
Good evening, Mr. Jagir Naik. I am Kumar from India. I am a Hindu. Past 1.5 years I am referring Quran. Here I have some doubts I should ask you. Why meditation is not preferable in Islam? And how rebirth is not believable in Islam? I hope there is only one Almighty God. But why he can't create? He is the only one creator. Why he can't create this all humanism is on good way and right way?
There are three questions. If I heard you correctly, your first question was, why is meditation not allowed in Islam? That was meditation. First question was meditation. The brother's three questions. The first was, why is meditation not allowed in Islam? And the second question that he asked was that why Almighty God did not create all human beings as good? Why some bad and some good? And the second one, middle one which you asked was rebirth. That why Islam doesn't believe in rebirth. That was the second question. As far as the first part of the question is concerned, that why is meditation not allowed in Islam? Brother, what do you mean by meditation is important? What do you mean by meditation? If you mean by closing your eyes and contemplating, the best form of a direct hotline to God is Salah in Islam. Salah, the prayers. The prayer what we offer is a direct hotline to God. Whether you consider meditation or not, that's a choice of words. The direct hotline to God is Salah. You come in direct in touch with God. But if you think that closing your mind, closing your eyes and keeping your mind empty and meditating, fine. How to meditate, how to reach Almighty God, the best person to say is God Almighty Himself. The best person who can show you how to reach Him is God Himself. So if you read in the Quran, the best part of the Salah, it is sujood. It appears in the Quran no less than 92 times. We put the highest part of the body, the forehead, on the lowest part on the ground, and it's Subhana bin Allah wa hamd. Glory be to Allah, the most great. Glory be to Allah, the most great. Glory be to Allah, the most great. And today the psychology they tell us that our body is directly under our control. Our mind is not under our control. Our mind, it keeps on wandering. However much you try, your mind cannot be under your control. Our body is under control. So in order to humble the mind, you have to humble the body. And there's no better way than to put the highest part of the body, the forehead, on the lowest part of the ground, and then say, glory be to Allah, the Most High, glory be to Allah, the Most High. And this form of worship is even given in your scripture. In the Hindu scripture, there is a worship called as Sashtant. Means eight parts. So when you touch the eight parts on the ground, it's called as Shashtang. Means eight parts. That is the forehead, that is the nose, two hands, two knees, and two feet. When you do sujood, when you do sajda, we touch our forehead and the nose on the ground, we touch our two hands, we touch both the knees and both the feet. So these eight parts in the Hindu scripture is called as Shashtang. Means eight parts. That is the form of worship. If you read the Bible, it's mentioned in Genesis, chapter number 17, verse number 3, that Abraham fell on his face and prayed to God. Book of Numbers, chapter number 20, verse number 6, Moses and Aaron, they fell upon their face and prayed to God. It's mentioned in the book of Joshua, chapter number 5, verse number 14, Joshua fell on his face and prayed to God. If you read the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus, kept peace be upon him, went to the Garden of Gethsemane, took a few steps forward, fell on his face and prayed to God. No gymnast can do better than the Muslims do by falling on the face and praying to God like we do, sajda. The best form of worship is the Salah, and the main part of Salah is the sajda. Regarding details of wudu and standing, everything, if you refer to my cassette on similarities between Islam and Hinduism, I have showed more similarities in Salah between Hinduism and Islam. If you see my video cassette, similarity between Islam and Christianity, I showed other similarities about wudu mentioned in the Bible, in the Quran, about praying in the Quran, wudu, taking off your shoes, all these things. It will take long, it's a question answer session. So the best form of hotline to God, it is Salah. If you go to Western countries, there's this new form called as Transcendental Meditation. Transcendental Meditation, a 14 letter word. Transcendental Meditation. And you have to pay through your noses. Our Salah is free. You know, now we have yoga in India. You know where you and I come from, yoga. And you have breathing techniques, etc. All these breathing, everything is included in Salah. If you see my talk, Salah, the program into righteousness, everything is a package, free package. It benefits you in this world and the year after. Your health benefits. May you do sajda, the abdominal visra. Today the doctors tell us that when you breathe, only 2/3 of the air is exhaled out and in. 1/3 is called as residual air. Now when you are doing sajda and when you breathe, the abdominal viscera, they press against the diaphragm. And the diaphragm presses against the lower lobes of the lungs. And this 1/3 residual air also comes out. So when you breathe, the more fresh air coming in. You don't have to do yoga and transcendental meditation and breathing technique. All is inclusive package. The health improves. There is circulation. There is circulation. When you do sujood, when you do sajda, there is increased blood supply to the face. There is less chance of having chilblains, the disease of the face. When you do sujood, there is drainage of the bronchial tree. Less chance of having bronchiectasis. When you do sujood, there is increased venous return of the abdomen. I can go on and on talking about medical benefits. Anyway, these medical benefits of Salah, it is only side dishes. This is not the reason why we pray for medical benefits. There's chance of having chronic backache, and I can go on and on, sinusitis. But this is only the sweet side dishes. Our main reason we offer is the hotline to God. It's because to pray to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These side dishes may attract the non-Muslims. Our main course, biryani, it is praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He ordered us and we pray to him to thank him. These are side dishes. Side benefits, but these side benefits are much superior than all your transcendental meditation and yoga. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Let's take from the women's section. And ladies, microphone number 3. So we'd like to hear from ladies, women. Is there any? Two more questions. Why we get the women ready?
Jazakallah. Therefore, we prefer one question at a time. Jazakallah. The brother asked 2 more questions. The second one was on rebirth. And the third one was that why didn't God create everyone good? The second point about rebirth. The Quran, what the Hindu scriptures speak is about punarjanam. Punar means next, janam means life. Even Quran speaks about punarjanam. We speak about next life. The Quran says we come in this world, then we live, then we die, and we are resurrected. Surah Baqarah, Surah Anfal, there are many verses. So we come in this world, we live in this world, then we die, we are resurrected. We believe in the next life. If you read the Rig Veda, if you read the Vedas, which is the highest authority in the Hindu scriptures, it speaks about punarjanam in Rig Veda, book number 10. It speaks about the next life. But the Hindu scholars, they come with a philosophy known as samskara, which is not mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. They come with a philosophy known as samskara, cycle of birth, death, that is reincarnation. This theory of reincarnation or cycle of birth, death is nowhere to be found in the Vedas and Upanishads. Even Bhagavad Gita, which they quote about talking about cycle of birth, death, is Bhagavad Gita chapter number 4, verse number 22. It says that a body, like a human being, throws away the old clothes and wears the new clothes. Similarly, the soul throws away the old body and puts on a new body. So this aspect we have got no problem. It throws away the old body, puts on the new body. In this world we die, our body is disintegrated, we are resurrected. It doesn't say throws away the old body, puts away the new body, then again the old body. It's not a cycle. It's only once. So this Bhagavad Gita matches with the Veda about Punarjanam. But the Hindus, similarly with, if you read Upanishad, it says that a caterpillar walks on the blade of grass and jumps to the next grass. Finish. It doesn't say the third grass and the fourth grass and the fifth blade of grass. But the reason the Hindu scholars have come up with the philosophy of samskara, cycle of birth, death, reincarnation, is because they could not understand, they could not realize why are some human beings born in a rich family, some in a poor family. Some are born healthy, some are born with congenital heart disease. So they said, how could God be unjust? So that's the reason they came with their own philosophy, saying that you are born with a congenital heart disease because you did a sin in the previous life. This is their own philosophy, not mentioned in the Vedas or the Upanishad. And they say that you are born sometime as animal, sometime as a bird, sometime as insect, sometime as human being, and maximum you are born, the highest form of birth is of a human being. Correct? And you become a human being 7 times. I am asking the question whether, is the sin in this world, is it increasing or decreasing? Increasing or decreasing? Increasing, very good, correct answer, easy answer. Is the population of the world increasing or decreasing? Increasing. If sin is increasing, the population of the human being should decrease. If the sin is increasing, the population of the human being should decrease. Why is it also increasing? Furthermore, if you read the Hindu scriptures, they have 2 types of the kingdom of peace. One type is ultimate kingdom of peace, moksha or nirvana. The other is when a person dies, he goes to swarga, temporary period. If he does good deed, if he does bad deed, he goes to nark, hell, and then again he's reborn. Now once a person, if he's done good deed, he goes to heaven, or if he does bad deed, he goes to hell, then why should he be born with a congenital heart disease? If he's gone to nark, if a person robs, the police puts him behind bars, once he comes out, he's a free man. You can't put him behind bars again unless he has committed some crime again. Correct? So once he's gone to nark and he comes back, why should he have a congenital heart disease again? Doesn't make sense. So this is the philosophy of the Hindu scholars, not of the Hindu scriptures. The Hindu scriptures speak about next life, Punarjanam, which even Islam speaks about Punarjanam, next life. How does Islam justify that some human beings are born with a congenital heart disease, some healthy, some rich family, some poor family? See, Quran says, in Surah Mulk, chapter 67, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mawta wal hayata. It's Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. This life that you are living is a test for the hereafter. Test for the hereafter. And the test paper always keeps on changing. You don't have the same test paper every time. Then what's the use of the test? The test paper keeps on changing. Now, depending upon the Almighty God, some people give some people easy test, some people difficult test. If the test is easy, the correction is strict. If the test paper is difficult, the correction is easy. For example, every rich human being who has a saving of more than the nisab level, 85 grams of gold, he or she should give zakat, 2.5% of the excess wealth. For a poor person, he gets full marks, 100 out of 100, enough to give zakat. But we say, arey garib aadmi, poor man, how sad. What poor man? He has got 100 out of 100 in zakat. Therefore, the Prophet said, easier for a poor man to go to Jannah, easier for the poor man to go to kingdom of peace than a rich man. So we, and according to our understanding, we say poor man. Actually, poor man has got 100 out of 100 in zakat. For the rich man, if he gives proper zakat, then he will get 100. Otherwise, if he gives 50% zakat, then he gets 50% marks. He may not give zakat, he will get zero. So for the poor man, in the test of zakat, 100 out of 100. For the rich man, maybe his test of hijab is easier. He has got many big house, many rooms. For the poor person in one bedroom flat, doing hijab is more difficult. So Almighty God tests different people in different ways. Some rich, some poor. For the child who is born with a congenital heart disease, we believe every child is born sinless. He is masoom. Just because a person is born with a congenital heart disease doesn't mean he has done some sin. He is sinless. Maybe the test for the parents. As Quran says in Surah Anfal, chapter 8, verse 28, the wealth and your children are a test for you. They are a fitna for you. They are a test for you. It's a test. It's a test for the parents. Maybe the parents are good and Allah wants to give them Jannat Firdaus. Didn't I say the verse of the Quran that Allah will give you a higher reward if you are patient? So maybe those parents are good Muslims, 5 times salah, etc. Allah wants to give them higher reward. You know, if you, and higher reward, higher test. A normal human being says, I've been praying 5 times a day, I give zakat, I'm so obedient. Why does my child have to be born with a congenital heart disease? So then he may not worship Allah the way he should. A good human being, a good Muslim will say, this is Allah's wish, no problem. At least I had a child. He will yet believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. More difficult the test, higher the reward. If you pass a graduate exam of arts, you get a BA. If you pass an examination of a medical examination, you get doctor in front of an MDR. Doctor.
I read it.
Difficult exam, the degree is higher, the honor is more. So more difficult the test, higher is the honor. So more difficult test, if you pass, you go to Jannat al-Firdaus, a higher level in the kingdom of peace. So that is the reason some people are born in a rich family, some people in a poor family, some people are born healthy, some people congenital heart disease. Almighty God tests different people in different ways. This life is a test for the hereafter. Coming to your third question. That why didn't Allah make all of the human beings good? Allah says in the Quran, in several places, if He wanted, He could have made all the human beings Muslim. All the people submit their will to Almighty God, if He wanted. But then where is the test? See, Almighty God has made the angels. Angels follow the commandment of Allah. Always. They have no choice of their own. We human beings have a choice to obey or disobey Almighty God. So human beings are the best creation of Almighty God. We have a choice. Now with this choice, if we obey Almighty God, we become higher than the angels. The angels are obeying God without test. They are just plain Muslims. They are obeying God. They have no free will. We human beings, after a free will is given, if we obey Almighty God, we become higher than the angels. If we disobey, then we become like the Satan. So if Almighty God wanted, He could have made all of them believe. But then what is the difference between the human being and the angel? If Almighty God wants, He can pass everyone in the test. For example, a teacher teaches in the class, mathematics 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. During examination, she sees, that teacher sees the student writing 2 plus 2 is equal to 5. If the teacher wants, the teacher can say, don't write 5, write 4. But the other student will object that the teacher is biased. She is cheating. This is the test. If Almighty God wants, He can put everyone in the kingdom of peace. Then where is the test? Then even the rapist will go to the kingdom of peace. Even the robber will go. Then where is the test? So this is the test for the hereafter. If you follow the commandments of Almighty God and the teaching of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, you enter the kingdom of peace. If you don't follow, you don't enter the kingdom. If you want, you could have put everyone in the kingdom of peace. But then where is the test? So this is the test we are undergoing. And if we pass this test, we enter the kingdom of peace. Hope that answers the question.
I know that you have so much to say, mashallah, for every question. And maybe we need more time for people to ask questions and have answers. Anyone from the women's section? Any female who wants to ask?
Hello. Yes, hello.
Please, non-Muslim.
There is no non-Muslim brother.
Go ahead. One
Amira teacher.
Okay.
She want to ask the one question. You said that the key to the kingdom of the peace is the boat. Concept of the God believe in the messenger. Would only the concept of the God be enough? How important is the belief of the messenger?
Thank you.
Sister asked the question that the key to the kingdom of heaven, to go to the kingdom of peace, you have to believe in God and the teachings of the messenger. Is Almighty God's teaching enough? How important is the teachings of the messenger? Indirectly asking, is the message of God, the Quran, sufficient? How important is the teachings of the messenger, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? Sister, according to the Quran, Quran says, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messenger. So even if you want to follow only the teachings of Quran, it's compulsory you have to follow the teachings of the messenger. In Surah Nisa chapter 4, 59, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messenger. So without following the teachings of messenger, you cannot follow the teachings of Quran according to the Quran. Furthermore, the teaching of the messenger is the commentary of the Quran. The Quran is a telegraphic book. It's just in short form. The more details, the commentary of the Quran, like how to offer, Quran says offer salah. How to offer salah, the details aren't given. Some points are given. Sujood is given, Qiyam is given. But details, where to keep your hand, how many rakats to offer. All these details are given in the teachings of the Prophet, that is the Sahih Hadith. So therefore, both are equally important, both are very important. Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the Messenger, follow the Quran and the teaching of the Prophet, that is the Sahih Hadith. Hope that answers the question. If there are any non-Muslim, we prefer non-Muslims asking questions. And non-Muslims are requested to come on the microphone. And the volunteers can let the non-Muslims come in the front, please.
Alright, thank you so much. Maybe for the second round, yes. I'll go now to number 5 upstairs on the first floor.
Yeah, please. There is a question.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, sorry, wait a minute. Sister, can you wait? Go ahead. Go ahead, yeah. Brother. Brother, go ahead. Yeah.
Good evening, my name is Krishna Rao.
A little far away from the mic,
yeah,
please.
Yeah. So my question is, if you have told that very nicely that all the religions believe that God is formless, I do agree with that. But if God is formless, how do we get it described in all the religion books, whether it's Quran or Vedas or Upanishads? And it's very rightly said that most of the Hindu, the Upanishads or Vedas have described the God as the Panchabhutas, the earth, the sky, the air, the fire and the water. Do you think that concept is to be contradictory? So how do we then describe a God when we say that there are so many messengers to the God that they have told to do like this and we can achieve to the kingdom of the peace? When the God doesn't have a form, how do we get that?
Thank you.
I request the people in the audio technician to see to it that the microphone is adjusted properly. Yeah. What I can understand from the brother's question is that how can all the scriptures say that God is formless? What do you mean to say about the punch thing, the natural thing like water, fire, etc., etc.? Brother, nowhere in my speech did I ever say that God is formless. I never said that God is formless. I said God does not have an image. You cannot see God in this world. As the Quran says in Surah Az-Zumur, chapter 39, verse number 8, that no eyes can comprehend God. In this world, you cannot see God. You cannot see the image of God. So God Almighty, as I mentioned, na tasya pratima asti, of that God, there is no pratima, there is no image, there is no statue, there is no picture, there is no painting, there is no portrait, there is no statue, there is no idol. Now your question is, then without these having images of Almighty God, how can you concentrate on God, is your question. So do you mean to say that you have to believe in natural things? What is mentioned in Yajurveda chapter 40 verse number 9? Andhatma pavishanti ya asambhuti mupaste. You are entering darkness if you worship the asambhuti. What you are talking about, 5 things are the asambhuti. Water, fire, air, etc. It says you are entering darkness if you worship the natural things. You are entering more in darkness if you worship the sambhuti, the table, chair, idol, etc. So worshipping the sambhuti and the asambhuti, both are wrong. Regarding a question that don't we require something to concentrate like the idols, etc. Now this philosophy of getting an idol for concentration is nowhere mentioned in the Hindu scripture. This is again the teachings of the Hindu pandits. Like how samskara is not mentioned in the Ved and the Upanishad. This is a teaching of the Hindu scholars. You know what they say? When I discuss with them, and if you see my talk on concept of God in Hinduism and Islam, Shri Ravi Shankar, supposed to be one of the most famous spiritual guru, and even he agreed when I quoted all these verses, what Dr. Zakir Naik is saying is correct. And whenever I meet a pandit, they say yes. They say, Zakir, you are right. I agree with you that the Vedas speak about this concept of one God, has got no image, no photograph, no painting. But, you know, in the initial stages, when we have not reached a higher consciousness, we require idol to concentrate. We require an idol to concentrate. When a person has reached the higher consciousness, then idol is not required. So I tell him, we Muslims have already reached that higher consciousness. See, this is their explanation. This is not mentioned in the Veda. It is their explanation. And you know, they tell me, one Pandit was telling me, you know, Brother Zakir, that suppose the child asks you, why does it thunder? So we say, I am a chakki pisriye. Grandmother is grinding flour. It is thundering and lightning because grandmother is grinding flour. Imagine if you tell your son that the thunder and lightning is because of grandmother's grinding flour in the heaven. When he goes to school and teacher says thundering is due to sudden expansion of rapidly heated air, he will think the teacher is telling a lie. When he realizes the teacher is speaking truth, he will start telling, my parents told me a lie. In Islam, we don't believe in this. We believe in speaking the truth, haq. We don't even believe in telling a white lie. If you cannot explain to your son that thundering is due to rapidly expanding heat, at least you should say, I don't know. But if you tell to your son today, I don't know, he'll say, Abba, why don't you know? So therefore you have to do your homework. So therefore what we believe, we should speak the truth. You know, normally we have many a times when you are staying in buildings, your child throws out toys. It's very common. Your child throws out toys. You know why? Because you play that game with your child. Kawa leke gaya. The crow has taken it away. You play that game na, a toy is there in your hand and chew. Kawa leke gaya. The crow has taken it. So even your child throws the toys out. Kawa leke gaya. My children, we stay in 10th floor. Never have any of my children throws out toys. Why? Because I never played that game with them. So if you teach wrong things, even they follow. What we believe, that the concept of oneness of God, Almighty God has got no image, no portrait, no picture, no statue, is the basis of maths. It's the basis of the concept of God. Imagine if your child is learning maths in school, and in standard one, the child says 2 plus 2 is equal to 5. You won't tell your son, no problem, when you come to standard 10, I will tell you 2 plus 2 is not 5, it is 4. You will tell your child, in standard 1 only, 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. And this basis of maths, basic equation, will remain the same. Even when he goes to standard 10, 2 plus 2 will remain 5, will remain 4. Even when he does PhD in maths, 2 plus 2 will remain 4, it will not change. So Almighty God, I've got no images, I've got no statue, is the basis of the concept of God. You can't say that initially we'll let him learn wrong things and then we'll teach him what is right. It's totally illogical. So these are the scholars of Hinduism which are misguiding, and most of the scholars of most of the religion, many a time for their ulterior benefits, whether it be Christianity or other religion, they try and misguide. That the best way is to go to your scripture. If you read the scripture and understand with understanding and follow it, you will understand the concept of God and understand the last and final messenger, and that will be your key to the kingdom of peace. Hope that answers the question.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Actually, just adding to that, you said that...
Sorry. We have to give the chance to others, please. Can we have the other question from mic number 6, please?
Yes.
Good evening, sir. My name is Shivaprasad. I am Hindu from India, Hyderabad. Sir, you have taken so many examples from Hindu scriptures, and you have told that the Antim Rishi, last messenger, will come. And his place of birth is also Sambala something. You have converted that the last messenger is Muhammad and the place of birth is Makkah. Is it this place and this Muhammad, is it for entire world? If it is entire world, why you are not allowing into Makkah non-Muslim? And second question, you have taken Bhagavan Rajneesh example as a god. But no, as per my knowledge, no Hindu scriptures as telling that he is a god. No one is accepting is a god. He is just putting his name as a Bhagavan. No Hindus are accepting as some is a god. Some he is a messenger, some mata pravakta something. Hindu mata pracharam like that. Thank how you. He was considered as a god.
Brothers asked two questions. The first question is that if the Antim Rishi Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, born in Makkah and Sambala, the city of peace, Why are non-Muslims allowed there? And second question, that Bhagwan Rajneesh, you said, no Hindu scriptures speak about Bhagwan Rajneesh. He's not Bhagwan, he put his own name. Brother, I never said in my speech that Hindus believe in Bhagwan Rajneesh. I said some human beings. I never said Hindus. I've read the Hindu scriptures. Nowhere in the Hindu scriptures is Bhagwan Rajneesh mentioned as God. He's a self-proclaimed God. He's a self-proclaimed God. Never did I say Hindus. It's mentioned in the Hindu scriptures. But there are many self-proclaimed Hindu gods also. Even Sri Sri Ravi Shankar considered him to be God. And there are many people worshipping Sri Sri Ravi Shankar also as God. That we can discuss in the next talk. Now coming to your first question. That if the Antim Rishi was born in the city of peace, Ambala, in Makkah, then why aren't non-Muslims allowed in this city of peace is a very good question. The reply to this question is, in every country, there are certain areas which are called as cantonment area. Areas of meant for defense, military defense, air force, etc. Now in this area, the cantonment area, I being a citizen of India, I'm an Indian, I will not be allowed in the cantonment area. Only those people who are involved with the defense of that country are allowed. I am a citizen, but I won't be allowed. That's the law of the country. Similarly, the Haramain, Makkah and Medina are the cantonment area of Islam. Only those, like how the people who are willing to die for the country, who are involved in the protection of the country, are allowed in cantonment area. Makkah and Medina is cantonment area of Islam. Only those who are willing to die for the religion of Islam are allowed in the cantonment area. If you are willing to die for this religion of peace, you are most welcome. And the other answer is, for every country, you require a visa. For example, to go to America today is the most difficult to get the source of peace, As-Salam. And the Quran mentions in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse 187. It says that for them is the home of peace in the presence of thy Lord. For thy Lord is their friend. And because they are righteous. So it's talking about the home of peace. The kingdom of peace is in the presence of thy Lord. For your Lord is your friend. And he loves you because you are righteous. It's mentioned in Surah Marij, chapter number 70, verse number 27 and 28. That they fear the displeasure of thy Lord. For displeasure of the Lord is opposite of peace and tranquility. They fear to displease the Lord, talking about the believers. Because if you displease God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the opposite of peace and tranquility. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 58. The salam, peace, it is a word from the Lord who is most merciful. It's mentioned in Surah Ibrahim, chapter 14, verse number 23. It says that those people who believe, those who have faith and do righteous work, these are the people that shall enter paradise, under which, beneath which are rivers flowing, and the greetings in this paradise is peace. Here it's talking about the criteria that if you believe, if you have faith and you do righteous work, then you shall enter Jannah, beneath which rivers will flow. It's mentioned for Hijr, chapter 15, verse number 46, that the greetings is enter with peace and security. It's mentioned in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 75, that the highest reward in Jannah and Paradise is those who are patient constants. Those who strive for patience and constancy. It's mentioned in Surah Maryam, chapter number 19, verse number 62, that in paradise there is no vain talk. There is no idle talk. There is only salutations of peace. And this kingdom of peace, the ultimate kingdom of peace, is Jannah. It is heaven. It's paradise. And the description of this kingdom of peace is mentioned in the scriptures of the major world religions. And if you read the Quran, it speaks about the kingdom of peace. One of its name is Jannah. That is paradise. The meaning of Jannah in Arabic is garden. A description is given as garden beneath which rivers flow. Rivers of milk with unchanging flavor. Rivers of pure honey, in which there is every kind of fruit. And the fruits are described as pomegranates, dates, grapes, etc. And in it, you will find that there is no idle talk. There is no vain talk. There is no cause of sin or no cause of distress or anxiety. It is a total place. It's a place of total peace and bliss. And Jannah is described in several verses of the Quran. Several times in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3, Surah Nisa chapter 4, Surah Maidah chapter 5, Surah Tawbah chapter 9, Surah Hijr chapter 15, Surah Qahf chapter 18, Surah Hajj chapter 22, Surah Fatir chapter 35, Surah Yasin chapter 36, several places the Quran speaks about this Jannah, about the kingdom of peace. And the same description of the kingdom of peace is given even in the Hindu scriptures. In several places, time will not permit to describe all, but it's mentioned in Atharva Veda, book number 4. Chapter number 36, verse number 6, Atharva Veda, book number 4, chapter 34, verse number 6, it says that this heaven, it's talking about, it has got rivers flowing beneath, streams of butter with banks of pure honey, rivers of distilled water, and curd, and rivers of milk. In several places it speaks about fruits. It's mentioned in Atharva Veda, book number 4, chapter number 36, verse number 2, that it is a place of happiness where you will find pure women. The same description of kingdom of peace is also given in the Bible. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 22, verse number 30, that when a person is resurrected, that person does not marry and cannot be married because they become angels of God. It's mentioned in the book of Romans, chapter number 21, verse number 4, that this is a place where there will be no sorrow. All your tears will be wiped out by Almighty God. There will not be death. There will not be pain. There will not be grief. It's mentioned in the Song of Solomon, chapter number 4, verse number 13, that in it are gardens and fruits, including pomegranates, etc. So the description of Jannah, the kingdom of peace, is given in the major, the scriptures of the major world religions. And the criteria to go to Jannah, it is the same. It's mentioned in Surah Al-Asr, chapter 3, verse number 103. Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1-3, which says, "Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa allazina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr." That by the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deed, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. There are basically two criteria required for Jannah, to go to kingdom of peace. It is Iman and righteous deed. In this Surah Al-Asr, More details are given of the second criteria, therefore it becomes four. One is Iman, righteous deed, exhorting people to truth, and exhorting people to patient perseverance. And the key to go to Jannah is the first pillar of Islam, mentioned Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, hadith number 8, which is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, that there is no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. The key to Jannah, in the scriptures of the major world religion, it is the same. That is, believing in no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. And this talk major deals with the key to the kingdom of peace, the key to Jannah. First, we'll discuss the first criteria, the concept of God in the major world religions. First, we'll discuss the key to the concept of God in Hinduism. If you ask a common Hindu that how many gods does he believe in, some will say 3, some will say 100, some will say thousands, while others will say 33 crores, 330 million. But if you ask a learned Hindu, he will tell you that the Hindus should believe and worship only one God. But the common Hindu, he believes in a philosophy known as pantheism. He believes that everything is God. The common Hindu believes that the tree is God, the sun is God, the moon is God, the human being is God, the snake is God. What we Muslims believe is, everything is God's, G-O-D with an apostrophe S. Everything belongs to God. The tree belongs to God, the sun belongs to God, the moon belongs to God, the human being belongs to God, the sun belongs to God. So the major difference between the Hindus and the Muslims is, the common Hindu says that everything is God. We Muslims, they say everything is God's, G-O-D with an apostrophe S. The major difference is the apostrophe S. If we can solve this difference of apostrophe S, the Hindus and the Muslims will be united. How do you do it? The Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, Talaw ila kalmitin sawa'im bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as in us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'buda illallah. That we worship none but Allah. And to understand the concept of God in a religion, it is not appropriate to observe what the followers of that religion are doing. The best and the most authentic way to understand the concept of God in a religion is to try and understand what the scripture of that religion has to speak about Almighty God. So let's try and understand the concept of God in Hinduism based on the scriptures of Hinduism. It's mentioned in the Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1. Ekam evidityam. God is only one without a second. It's mentioned in the Shweta Sitara Upanishad, chapter number 6, verse number 9. Na chasya kasij janita na chadipa. It's a Sanskrit quotation which means, of that God, there are no parents. He has got no lords. Almighty God has got no father. He has got no mother. He has got no superior. It's mentioned in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. The meaning of pratima in Sanskrit means images, photographs, pictures, sculptures, statues, idols. Of that God, there is no pratima. Of that God, there are no images. There are no pictures. There are no portraits. There are no paintings. There are no statues. There are no idols. There are no sculptures. And the most sacred scripture, which is most widely read, it is the Bhagavad Gita. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 7, verse number 20. All those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires, they worship demigods. Means that the materialistic people, they do idol worship. It's mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 10, verse number 3. They know me as the unborn, the supreme, the Lord of all the worlds. And amongst the Hindu scriptures, the most sacred are the Vedas. It's mentioned in Yajur Ved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Na tasya pratima asti. Of that God, there is no pratima. As I mentioned earlier, pratima means images, photographs, paintings, pictures, idols, sculptures, statues. Of that God, there is no pratima. Of that God, there are no images, there are no pictures, there are no paintings, there are no portraits, there are no sculptures, there are no statues, there are no idols. It's mentioned in Yajur Ved chapter number 40, verse number 8. Almighty God is pure and imageless. It's mentioned in Yajur Ved chapter number 40, verse number 9. Andhatma bhavishanti ya asambhuti mupaste. They are entering darkness, those who worship the asambhuti. Asambhuti are the natural things like fire, water, air, etc. And the verse continues, they are entering more in darkness, those who worship the sambhuti. Sambhuti are the created things like table, chair, idols, etc. Who says that? Yajur Ved chapter 40, verse number 9. It's mentioned in Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 58, verse number 3. Dev Maha Asi. Great is Almighty God. And the most sacred amongst all the Vedas is the Rig Ved. It's mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 164. Verse 46. Ikkam sat vipra bahuda vadante. Truth is one. God is one. Sages, saintly people call him by a variety of names. And there are no less than 33 different attributes given to Almighty God in Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 1 alone. One amongst the attribute in Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3 is Brahma. Brahma is called as the creator. If you translate into Arabic,